Hello everyone, Elizabeth Bishop, Autodesk Fusion instructor here. Today's video, we're going to look at the different ways of exporting an STL file for 3D printing. So starting off with our file that we want to export as an STL for 3D printing. Now, you may remember from our exporting different file types video, you can go file and export. And one of the options for this is STL. Now you could of course use this file export tool for exporting our STLs, but I'm going to show you a few different ways that we can export our STLs, which give us more control over that mesh and the different bodies and formats that we want to export from that. So let's jump into that. So what we're going to do is go up to File and then 3D Print. So this is going to take our whole file, and there's different options in our 3D print utility here. So the first of these is manufacturing. Now, if you're looking to create your G-code directly for your machine, this is a good place to start. We'll come back onto this in a moment. If we take a step back and we're just looking to create that mesh file to share, say, on a platform or to use directly in a slicer for 3D printing, the option we want to use is export. Now in here, we can then select the objects we want to export. So selecting this one body here, and we have different file format options: 3MF, STL binary, STL ASCII, and OBJ. The different mesh file formats that we have determine the amount of information contained within our file. Now for 3D printing from Fusion, there's not too much difference in the file format that we create. I like to use an STL binary. My units for this are millimeters, so I want to match these to my document settings. And then we have our mesh refinement settings. Now the default is usually medium in here. If we click the preview button, you can see that this creates a mesh here. Now on our flat surfaces, there's not going to be too much difference, but on our curved surfaces, this will create difference. I tend to go for a high refinement of my mesh if I'm using something with curved surfaces. This means it will take an approximation of any curved surface and approximate this with a number of triangles. Generally, the higher your refinement of mesh, the larger your file size will be, and some slicers can't handle such big files. You can also create personalized adjustments using the slider bars to create custom settings there. You would then click OK, and it will ask you where you would like to save your file. And you can open up your browser to select your file location and give it a name. The next option in our 3D print utility that I'm going to talk through is print utility. So this here is where we can send our STL file directly to a slicer. There's a couple of built-in options in our print utility. So we can send directly to Bamboo Studios if we're doing fused filament fabrication, or if you're using SLA printing, you could send directly to Preform if you've got a form 3D printer. When you select this, it will select the default file format that generally that slicer likes to use. And again, you can do those mesh refinement settings. That will directly select Bamboo Studio from your settings and open up the application for you and bring in that file format directly into Bamboo Studio, ready for you to slice using your settings for 3D printing. And there we go, that's brought that file directly into Bamboo there. And that's a great quick step to reducing the number of steps you need to take in your 3D printing workflow. Now, if we go back to that 3D print setting there, and say you don't use Bamboo or Preform and you want to select an application for your custom slicer, your preferred slicer, you can add in a custom application here. So you can select on the application here in your File Explorer and select from your computer. And generally this will be located somewhere in your PC settings and your program files. For example, if I wanted to add Simplify as my slicer, we'll go to the .xex for that, click open, and then this will put that as my custom application. Again, I can select my object from the browser window and click OK. And this will automatically add this into my slicer where I can set my settings for 3D printing. Now this here is just a single file, but what happens when you have an assembly file that you want to export? Now, if we have a look at this setup here, we can see there's multiple parts in here. If I went to file and 3D print, we can select the individual parts, but I can also select the whole assembly to print. When you do this, a secondary option comes up, which is your structure. So you can either export the entire assembly as one file, or you can export as one body per file. And this will create a file structure with a single file for each of the bodies. And then you can use these in your slicer. This is particularly useful if you are creating multicolor prints that require separate bodies for each of the parts in the slicer settings. So that's how we can export our files using the 3D print utility. The 3D print utility can also be found from the utilities bar at the top, and you can click make and then 3D print from there. That takes you to exactly the same menu. Now, an option I often use is actually when I'm working on a file and I just want to directly export the file for 3D printing. So if I select that same X mount that I've got in the assembly file, I'll see that it's in here. And say I'd been working on this independently, you can right click on this from your browser tree and click save as mesh. Now, this takes you to the same print utility menu, but it's just called save as mesh. You have exactly the same settings, so manufacturing, export, and 3D print utility from there. So there's one final thing that I'd like to show you in this video, and this is the built-in section in the Autodesk Fusion manufacturing workspace. So that first option when we went to file 3D print was manufacturing. So selecting this file, I can go into the manufacturing workspace. And it comes up with this message, would we like to switch to the manufacture workspace? So this is going to take us from our design workspace into our manufacturing workspace. Now this pops up with our machine library. So Fusion has a number of built-in libraries that we can utilize. So there's all of these commercially available 3D printers that we can select as a basis for this. Or if you want a clean starting point, you could select the Autodesk generic FFF machine. So selecting this one takes us through the process and asks us to select what material we are going to be printing. So this is our print setting library. So I'm just going to make sure I'm selected from an FFF technology, and I'm going to select PLA, a very common 3D printing material. I get a small warning which says no model selected. So all models slash solids will be used. So do I want to ignore the warning? I'll just click yes for now. Now we've got our file and this is selected here. So I just want to position this component in the right location. So you can move this using the move tab here and pop that into the middle of the 3D printer. Now, once we have our file in here, you can then generate your additive toolpath. So we can generate that here using the default settings in this scenario. And once your toolpath has been generated, you can simulate that additive toolpath if you'd like to check through each layer and check your settings there. And then you can post-process this. So in this case, the post-process is going to provide you with that G-code that you can then pop on your 3D printer. So you want to check that your post is the one for that 3D printer that you want to use, and you can generate that G-code directly. And that's going to create an NC extension of a G-code. Now, the Fusion Additive Workspace is really that advanced setting. If you're using a commercially available 3D printer, it will often have a proprietary slicer with that, where you would need to create those STL files. So that there is a very brief overview of exporting your STL files from Autodesk Fusion for 3D printing. I hope you've enjoyed this video. If you've got any questions, please do post them in the comments section below. If you've liked this video, give it a thumbs up, and I'll see you in the next video.